Well, again, welcome everybody. It's Sunday afternoon, and this is the first time we've gotten together in the last few years. So we hope that this will continue on, and we'll be in good shape for many more Sunday afternoons to come. And today, we have this exhibit going about the Cat Mother group from the 70s, who are here and very, very successful. And we have Nick Wilson, who's going to talk and show us some of the photographs and go into the poster art that was popular at the time. And we have two people who haven't arrived as yet, Chuck Hathaway and Mervin Gilbert, but we're hopeful. Maybe they'll join us, maybe they won't, but we'll have a good time. And Katie Taya, the museum's treasurer, will interview. Thank you, Katie. And, of course, we have Maynard, who is our chief cinematographer, and we thank him. So, let's get underway. Thank you.
Well, I want to talk a bit when we start about how this presentation today came to be, and that when we first started talking about Cat Mother, of course, the poster art of the time and the drawings that went along with the time were one of the things we talked about sharing with people. And in the midst of this exhibition coming together, we had a curator leave and a new curator come in, and plans change, and we were getting close to the end of the exhibit, and I said, we want to talk about the illustrators, because these people were a vital part of our community at the time and the place. And so we pulled this together really quickly. And obviously, technology is not always your friend when you want to get something. We may just have to hire somebody to sit here and run their finger across the screen or whatever, or I brought it the old-fashioned way. But we hope to have Mervin is talking about life in the Northwest Nowhere, Mervin Gilbert. Chuck Hathaway, who was instrumental with starting the A&E magazine for the Mendocino Arts Center, and then years and years of real estate magazines that always had an artistic touch to them. And then we couldn't get John Chamberlain here because he's been dead for a few years, but we got his best friend, Nick Wilson.
9 years. Yeah.
9 years, who's also a photographer of that era, to talk a little bit about what a diverse group of people these were, and how they ended up on the Mendocino Coast, how they got here. And when we think about the Mendocino Arts Center forming and people with artistic backgrounds coming to Mendocino, one of the questions that I had on my handy dandy list of questions that I wanted to ask the gentlemen were, was it important to them to come to a community where there was an active art scene going on? And the other thing that fascinated me is that most of these guys had art education and had careers in commercial artwork in big cities.
Well, Chuck did, for sure. Yeah.
Chuck did, yeah. And other people were trained in the fine arts and had careers in the fine arts. How the heck did they end up in Mendocino? But that's something that Mervinius, in the opening pages of Life in the Northwest Nowheres, which we are selling for $5 today if anybody's interested, he gave a whole background of how he came to be here. Chuck Hathaway has talked a little bit about it. Do you know how John ended up here, how he came to be here?
Yeah, that's part of my story about John.
Go ahead.
John Chamberlain is from Ohio in the Cleveland area, and he began studies at, he attended Ohio State University. I don't know whether he got a degree or what, or even what he studied, but he ended up going to New York to seek his fortune, and he ended up becoming an advertising illustrator for an ad agency in New York. It didn't take too long before he got bored with that, and he decided to go seek his fortune elsewhere. He came west. He connected with, I'm having name problems. Hey, I'm 81. Give me some credit. So, I mean, cut me slack. The Hepcats, Paul Johnson. So he connected with Paul Johnson, another musician Well, he wasn't even, John wasn't really a musician at first, he became one. So they decided to go, they heard that there were positions available as extras on the movie Paint Your Wagon with Lee Marvin, among others, in Oregon, and so they decided to go there and they got jobs as extras and they did that. And then afterwards, on the way back south, they stumbled into Mendocino and they found that the Pie Wacket Cafe was open at the corner where the clock shop, the binocular and science store,
the bank.
Out of this world.
Bank of America.
Yeah. Yeah.
Out of this world.
Yeah.
Out of this world. Yeah. But anyway, it was the Pie Wacket on the corner, which is now, what is it called now? The
Out of this world.
Out of this world.
No, no.
Trillium.
The restaurant.
Trillium.
Yeah, that's it. So that was the site of a little restaurant cafe called the Pie Wacket. I thought there was a menu here on the wall somewhere.
There might be.
There might be. And it was a place where people could just hang out. You could get breakfast for essentially 50 cents because you get, it was 20 cents for endless refills coffee and 10 cents for a lumpy dump muffin, which was good with fruit and nuts and stuff in it. So 50 cents, that was my favorite breakfast when I first showed up in 1970. So it was also a place to play music. And when Cat Mother, when the forerunners of, what do you call them, the scouts of Cat Mother was looking for a place to move to, they had ended up in they came from New York to get away from their evil manager. They ended up in Bolinas, I think, at first, but they could be, started with a B, and they decided to look for a place they could afford to live, and they were hearing rumors that there were, you could get a place in Mendocino for $50 a month for a farm or something like that, so they decided to come try it. And Roy and Ellen, I think, were the first two, and they ended up meeting John Chamberlain at the Pie Wacket and were referred to a place where they might stay. At the time, they had money because they had just sold their second album. Pardon me, Maynard, while I grab it.
Because I see it over here.
They had just sold this album, and John Chamberlain did the, they actually made a wood carving, and he painted it, and you know, did all this graphics, and they combined it with a photo of a cabin, and here's the whole group of musicians and their families sitting on the deck of that cabin, which belonged to a guy named Rick Lane. Anyway, they had broken with their manager, who had them under a slave contract for 5 years, and they managed to record this album on their own initiative in San Francisco and sold it directly to the record company. So they had money, a lot of money for them anyway, you know, $20,000-$30,000. And they rented the Playhouse right next to Dick's Place on Main Street, which is, what, I guess about a half a block over there, right next between the Mendocino Hotel and the Kelley House. You can see it from here. So it was called the Mendocino Playhouse. It had been a little theater. It was at one time called the Music Box. And then later it was the Mendocino Playhouse, or maybe it was before. But anyway, it had a little theater.
That's the right sequence.
It was what?
Right sequence.
Playhouse was first, and then it was
Music Box.
Yeah.
At any rate, it had a little theater space with a mezzanine where you could see from the second level down. And they thought this would be great for a rehearsal space. So they set up their instruments. And they had a lot of rooms upstairs. It had two levels upstairs. It had been a fashionable boarding house, right, Madam Kate? And the two married men, Bob and Roy, the leaders, the founders of the band, found a house in Elk that they could rent. But all the single guys and the crew members were living in the Playhouse.
Sure.
Who's arriving? Come on in.
entree view.
The water's fine.
Chuck, come on.
Come on, come on, take it. We were expecting.
No, put him right there.
No, sit him over there.
We'll pull the chair for
we got more bit. Space.
Have a seat.
Hi, Chuck.
Hi, man.
I think since you're one of the artists here, or you can unmask if you choose to.
I can do what?
Take your mask off if you want to.
Sure. I can take it off?
If you choose to, yeah. I took mine off. So anyway.
I don't know, is everybody vaccinated?
Yeah, and everybody's wearing masks except you and me and Bruce, and he doesn't care.
I was wearing it.
Oh yeah, I know you were, so. So anyway.
I'm just saying your hearing aid too.
So, John Chamberlain, he was a wonderful, very likable, charismatic kind of guy who was enormously skilled in graphics. And he had his own style. He never used a computer in his life that I know of. He did everything the old-fashioned way, all the lettering by hand. He didn't use stencils or any of the shortcuts that many graphic artists use. And you can recognize his lettering as soon as you see it. I mean, there were so many different styles he developed. This actually is a John Chamberlain calendar that was put together by Chuck Hathaway after John passed in 2013. And I guess this was for, what is it for, 2014? I'm not on the front page, so at any rate. There's a fine example. The whole calendar is full of beautiful examples of John Chamberlain's work. And
shall we give Chuck a chance to tell us how he got here?
Yeah.
You want to tell us how you got here? What brought you to Mendocino?
I drove down the hill.
What brought you Chuck, here the first time?
Chuck, before you start, let me tell you, if you have trouble talking, we did an interview during the 70s, which you probably don't even remember, but I did, and I took an excerpt out of that, which I have made an audio excerpt, which you can play if you don't want to talk. You decide.
We want to.
I might say something off color. You know?
We want you to respond.
It's Mendocino.
I'd like to hear you.
Yeah.
I say both. Let's just do both.
How did you find Mendocino? How did you discover Mendocino?
On a vacation with my family. Went back home, sold my house, and came back up.
When was that?
A long time. Another lifetime ago.
What, do you remember the year?
It was either 70 or 71, sometime in there.
It was 70. He moved up in 71.
Mm-hmm. Sounds reasonable.
Did you come because it was an artistic community, or did you come just because you liked it?
Well, actually, I was raised in West Hollywood, moved to North Hollywood, moved to Newbury Park, and then from Newbury Park, I figured the best way to get out of Southern California was to move to Northern California.
That sounds logical.
I mean, the growth was pushing me out. That's kind of what happened.
And I know you were instrumental with helping start the Mendocino Art Center's A&E magazine, and then you did the real estate magazine, but you're one of those people that wasn't afraid of computers. How'd you manage
that? No, that was fun. Actually, it was it kept me longer than I wanted to be in still business, so, you know.
Well, it's not something everybody adopted for lifestyle.
Yeah. That was good. I don't know. Everybody's here, so, you know, that's. It's still rural in my lifetime. Mm-hmm. And that's. That's what I was looking for when I moved up.
When he's representing John Chamberlain in spirit today, since John Chamberlain can't be with us, I am a person that knows nothing about art, basically. When you guys were envisioning your art, or envisioning a piece of artwork, were you envisioning the whole picture in your mind, or were you envisioning segments of the picture in your mind? I look at the work that cartoonists do, or work that you do, like the dinosaurs in Mendocino Bay, the land whales. Did you see that whole picture in your mind when you started working on it? Or did you just have ideas on how it was going to go together? Did you have segments of it that went together?
Well, interestingly enough, that grew out of another group of people that I hung out with. J.D. Mayhew, Ken Michelson, and others involved, which my limited memory recalled. I got to reach back really far. But they were all doing whales, and J.D. kind of instituted it. He said, "Why don't you do whales?" I said, "I don't do whales. I do dinosaurs." So that's where that idea came from.
Do we have that graphic?
The ideas were all grown by conversations.
The image of the dinosaurs in Mendocino Bay is beloved by every little kid in Mendocino who thinks that's just so cool to look at.
That was fun.
I wanted to thank you for it. The work that these artists did, I think, both for John Chamberlain and for your imagination, is such a reflection of the time. And I'm sorry Mervin isn't here today, because his life in the Northwest nowheres. Bruce, can you tell me, how do you properly pronounce Marceline?
How are you pronounced?
Marceline and Hector, his two people.
He had
a man and a woman in his comic book series that's in there that were so typically, in my mind, Albion hippies, excuse me, for the period of time, and the kids and the dog that would talk back to him. And I visually treasure some of the images that Mervin did. Particularly, he did one called The Great Mendocino Rain Dance. And it's a panel of the first rain, the first heavy rainfall in the fall, back when we used paid telephones. And six hippies lined up in front of the telephone waiting to call home to say, "Get the guitar out of the meadow! Get my poems out from under the apple tree and get stuff indoors!" And he did that, and he did another one of a drive to Cloverdale. And his lady is driving, and he's sailing his hand. He's air sailing his hand out the window of the car as they're driving down the road with a commentary the whole time about how the plane's doing as it's sailing through the air. And by the time he does this, his wife turns around to him and says, "Three people just drove off the road behind you." So I enjoy the kind of art that can be remembered by people one way or the other. Do you know if John ever did any editing on his posters, or did he just sit down with pen and pencil in his hand and go?
Well, he usually did a pencil, a light pencil sketch of the, sometimes he'd do a separate, pencil, like a rough out kind of. And then he'd go from that. But usually when he was inking it and coloring it, he would use a little pencil guide, but then he would carefully ink it with ink and, colored stuff. Later on, he used multicolored fiber tip pens for some of his stuff.
Chuck, when you were doing your stuff, did you pencil ahead of time, or were you working in ink originally when you were doing your dinosaurs in Mendocino Bay or any of your work?
No, most of my work was, I guess you would call it commercial in nature, because that's what I had an office up in Fort Bragg. I spent most of my time up there. I was doing a lot of outside work, you would call it.
Well, I think for for any artist on the coast, were you able, you had a business structure around you. You were able to support yourself off your art?
Oh, yeah. No, I,
and was John able to support himself off his art?
Yeah. I mean, he survived.
He survived.
That was his income. I mean, he always undercharged everything. He did a a letterhead and a logo and business card stuff for me, and it was always like $10, $20.
Or free.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, especially for anybody that was doing posters for fundraising events or something like that. What? Do you know if Mervin supported himself off of his artwork? Or did he have a day job too?
He had a rich wife.
He had a rich wife. Well, that counts. I know that there are some artists that take great pride over the fact that they supported themselves off of their art and supported their families off their art, but I know a heck of a lot of other artists who were doing three different things along with their art. So,
I mean, he got paid for a lot of stuff that he did, but things like Gloriana posters, he probably got $25 the most.
Probably.
But yeah. He did get paid well for something. I mean, yeah. Even Chuck did. Occasionally, didn't you get paid well? Occasionally.
Well, most of the income came from other companies outside of the area that found me up here from Los Angeles.
I mean, I've tried to remember. All right, I did the first few. I published the first four issues of the Mendocino Review, and Chuck and Camille Lang published the last five. But I know I probably paid all three artists something, but probably not much. And for Mendocino Funnies, I know John did the cover and the story. He didn't get paid to do that.
Yeah, that was my next question. I don't know if people know, but there was a series of comic books called the Mendocino Funnies that had contributions.
Well, there's only one.
There's only one? I thought there were more than one.
Just one.
Well,
just
JC one. Did one. John Chamberlain did a Funnies. I got the panels.
Yeah, we did panel, but I mean, there was only one issue of a magazine.
It was titled Mendocino Funnies. I don't know what the title of JC's was or whether it was ever actual print, but I've got the scans of the original art.
One of my favorite John Chamberlain stories is the T-shirt that I am wearing right here, which is typical of John Chamberlain art. I don't know, Cowboy Bob or Country Bob? This guy had a name.
Outdoor Bob. The little guy with the nose is the little beatnik. That's all.
Oh, the little beatnik. Okay. You can't see it, but on the little beatnik's head it says, "You light him, we fight him." But we had, and we had this T-shirt designed for years, and about the time that we were ready for our 30th anniversary in Conchie, we had a new T-shirt made. And if you and I don't know who did this, but if you look at the T-shirt, the guy's mustache has been trimmed and his hair has been cut, right? John Chamberlain did not give permission for this to happen. And John Chamberlain came back to the Mendocino Volunteer Fire Department chief of the time and said, "Excuse me, if you want to use my artwork, you take it back to this." And immediately, the artwork, the guy grew his mustache and his hair grew long again, and for all the years that we used Chamberlain illustrations after that, he looked the way he was supposed to look. And that was our Conchie story with John Chamberlain. I know that we were given, the Kelley House was given, and I dragged these out, so I want to go through them real quick. The Kelley House was given a lot of John's artwork, and
that's original stuff.
Yeah, it's original stuff, and the amount of the groups a benefit for the Mendocino Recreation Center. This one that was on the screen earlier was John sells out.
He was selling off his material to finance his trip to Hawaii.
Yeah. The first poster that he ever did, at least it says the first known poster that he ever did in 1967 for a show in L.A. Oh. Just a graphic panel of life in the...
Yeah, that's from the comic book.
North West Nowhere.
commercial art, you know, Big River Tree Service people, you know, just regular art, logo work for people. And then this, for people here who are old enough to remember the Seagull Cellar Bar, napkin art, or the equivalent of napkin art.
Yeah, yeah.
That Dave Jones has a large selection of it that John did. A band burger for $1.49 music at the Mendocino Hotel.
And that's for, dollar, it's Mark Levine Review, and that's the particular event was, they call themselves a band burger.
Christmas cards. I had never known that John Chamberlain did Christmas cards.
Should have brought mine.
Like I said, we inherited a lot of this stuff. Kid Dollars as a fundraiser for a community organization. Oh, Harvest Market. A lovely, almost looks like an etching. This is a Big River Review cover for marijuana, and I don't have my glasses on, 1984. Mendocino Theater Company poster. And the graduation program for the Mendocino Community School. So I think all of the artists that were working at the time did a variety of different kinds of work or stuff one way or the other. You're an artist. Nick is a photographer. If a young person comes to you that likes art and cartooning and says, what do I do to be famous? What do you tell them? Famous or infamous?
Move to New York.
Find another line of work.
That's a good question. If I get an answer, I'll let you know.
You're supposed to be one of the elders. You're supposed to have the answers to these things. Would you recommend a kid trying to make a career in cartoon art or illustration in this day and age if they're talented?
Oh, absolutely. No question about it. If you got the motivation, do it.
If you love it.
Yeah, because somebody's got to take over from you guys.
Absolutely.
What about you with your photography? If you don't know, this is the author of, or the photographer for Mendocino in the 70s, which we have in the other room.
Where's my book? I'm supposed to hold it up and say, buy my book.
I have maybe a copy of it on the table back there, but we moved it over in the other room. But it is in the back there. Do you see a new crop? Yeah. Do you see a new crop of young photographers coming up? There's the... Pass it forward, Victor, so he could hold it proudly.
No, that's okay. I don't have to hold it. A lot of people could pass it around and look at it, but then they wouldn't be paying attention. Okay. So here's the book. This is based on a talk that I gave here at the Kelley House in 2006. And I was to do a talk, and I said, okay, I'll do a slideshow. And the problem is that a lot of my photos were black and white, like this one, not color, like the back. And so I said, well, how am I going to do black and white slides? Oh, I know. I'll digitize them, and I'll get a digital projector. And then I can integrate the color in the black and white. So I did that, and then I thought, well, if I'm going to do this talk, then maybe I should have a book. I could sell the book at the talk, and that way I could make a little money. Well, it took a lot longer to put the book together than I thought it would, and I had it out in time for Christmas that year. And I had a first printing of 200. I did some advance sales of about 120 copies, and I had 80 more, and they were gone within a week of arrival at the gallery bookstore where we had the opening. So I ordered more, and anyway, it's been since 2006. It's been a few years now, and it still sells. In fact, I've got one I'm supposed to deliver to a fellow who lives out at where Val Powick's place used to be. Old timers will recognize that name as a man who was sort of left in social nature. And when the hippies were getting rousted by the rednecks in the early days, there was a lot of enmity. And first they were rousted off of Big River Beach, and then they settled in a meadow out in Jackson State Forest, and then they got rousted out of there, and then they were going to go, and Val Powick opened his land for them. So anyway, the guy who owns it or lives there now has ordered a book from me, and I still have to deliver it to him.
I have to say, these photos that are on the wall right here, the little girl in the bottom of the second photograph, The grandchildren unit of Cat Mother was here earlier today. The grandkids of Cat Mother. And that little curly haired face now, of course, is grandmother, looks old enough to be a grandmother herself.
Actually, they're the daughters. The daughters of Cat Mother, yeah.
Yes. But it was, they came in here and they looked at the pictures and the photo albums we have there and were just thrilled. I mean, they were seeing pictures that they hadn't seen before. And I think a lot of that is because photographers like you and sketch artists were preserving them in one form or the other in the artwork they did.
Well, my first dollar as a photographer was that Commerce Battery photo of Cat Mother. And it's because they had a change of personnel. A friend of mine from Texas had become the lead guitar player, and they needed a new publicity photo that didn't have the old band members in it. And so they hired some guy, and I sort of piggybacked on his session, because he was taking a long time to get ready, and they were standing around down an elk, you know, just talking to each other, waiting for him to get ready. So meanwhile, I snapped candid photos of them. And when they got the results back, they liked my photo and offered to pay me $50 for it, which is like at least 500 now, you know, because this is 1971. That's when when houses rented for $40 or $50 a month for a multi-bedroom house here in town. So different money. But yeah, that's how I decided I was going to be a photographer, is that I had success with that. And it was like my first role of black and white film that I developed myself. So I said, oh, okay, this is what I need to do. So I did. I was already hanging with Cat Mother. I mean, I already had an inside line, on it. I used to travel with them as a roadie and photographer, documentary photographer from 71 onward, until they ultimately dissolved in a series of stages. Mm-hmm. So I'll yield the floor.
I know we have more posters on the screen here, and do we have your...
Well, I didn't put that up, but I have something that I want to show for Mervin's anyway.
Okay, do you want to step up and plug that in?
Yeah, if we can get it to work right. That's another...
The joys of modern technology.
Problem.
Meanwhile, has anybody heard me good
Katie,
jokes?
Katie, I'm going to have to get... That's exactly where I have to go.
Uh-oh.
Sorry.
Then I'll go that way.
You're all right, Chuck.
I would kind of like to add.
So I do have that excerpt, but I'll get a copy of the entire interview for you, so you don't have to listen to it now.
You had a question, Beth?
I can get this in here.
Okay.
Nicholas, on the Alvin Dewa album, The Cabin there, where is that? That's still around?
East Casper. And I hear it's still standing. I haven't seen it in years and years. It used to belong to Rick Lane, and he did some photographs of them, including the ones for that album cover.
Phil Hildenbrand, who did the whole Cat Mother thing, tried to go there. Whoever owns it now wouldn't let them on the property.
That's right. So anyway, we hear it's still there.
Okay, so just to prelude on this.
There you are.
I don't know what that is. Oh, that's must be the chick. Okay, so my younger daughter, who is now 41, when she was watching Sesame Street and the Muppets and everything else, that year, 90, I put together, this is Mark 1976, I know we're going to see it done, but anyway, I put together, Mervin gave my wife and I a cartoon for Christmas, so I put together with Muppets music background, so it doesn't last longer than something else.
Don't you remember them good times, baby? Don't you remember them good times, baby? Don't you remember them times? Don't you remember them good times, baby? Don't you remember when the people weren't crazy? Don't you remember them times? Don't you remember when we could sing? Don't you remember when we could sing, yeah? Don't you remember them times? sing by most anything. Don't you remember them times? I would give up the memories and all those things that are made of this for me. Don't you remember them good times, baby? Don't you remember them good times, baby? Don't you remember them times? Don't you remember them good times, baby? Don't you remember when the people weren't crazy? Don't you remember them times? Don't you remember when we could sing? Don't you remember when we could sing, yeah? Don't you remember them times? Don't you remember when we could sing by most anything? Don't you remember that?
Thank you.
Properly ejected.
I wanted to pay tribute to John Chamberlain as a business person in, on the coast. When Bob and I got together, we decided we would go into business together and do something. And we chose to do a magazine. It was a time when people were talking about the dirty hippies. And Bob was living out on Sherwood Road, where they weren't dirty hippies. They had earth on their hands, and they were building their own, you know, they were building their own lives and their own shelters. And so we decided to do a magazine without any real experience about ever doing a magazine before. And I went to John for our masthead.
Chamberlain, right.
Chamberlain for our masthead. And told him what we wanted to do. And he created this just gorgeous representation of new settlers that took us through for 33 years. Often, you know, I was pretty sure that what was inside the magazine was a little bit closer to shit than to real. Real endeavor, but not John's artwork. It always stamped it as, hey, this is an authentic magazine, bias.
Anybody else with a question?
Yes, I had a question. I was wondering, sir, what made you choose that family for your front cover of your book?
They lived next door to Bob Smith, the leader, keyboard player, Cat Mother and Elk, and I was visiting Bob one day. And I noticed the neighbors were kind of out in the yard. And they had a little man, wife, and a little boy that only had one kid at the time. And there was this gorgeous scene across the road from them. And I said, hey, and this was like 4 or 5 weeks after I decided I was a photographer after my success with Cat Mother, the Commerce truck shop. And I said, would you stand over here by the road and let me take a family picture. I'll make you some prints of it. And they said, sure. So I did. And that was the result. They liked the result. I liked it. I had some commercial success with it. The California Living Sunday magazine of the San Francisco Examiner Chronicle ran it at some point. I barely remembered that until I found it. Some paperwork about it. And when it came time to choose a cover shot for my book, I decided that was the perfect one. That it would, it was so typical of people of that day, 71. It was 1971, February, in fact. And I got permission. Tony had, the husband had passed away, and Ella Russell, the wife, was still going strong. She has since passed away, unfortunately. So I asked her if I could have permission to use that on the cover of my book. And she said, well, of course, but you have to give me a copy of the book. I said, okay, it agreed. And later, when there was having a pre-funeral party for Ella when she was, you know, fading away in Casper, and they had a big gathering of the Jewish shul there, and people could speak to her, wanted to come sit and speak to her face to face. And so my turn came, and I thanked her so much for, you know, letting me use that photo for the book cover and for free. And she says, "No, but you paid me. You paid me a copy of the book." So she was a sweet lady. So that's how that photo came about. It was a practice shot for doing family photos, basically. It was the first family photo I attempted. I had beginner's luck, okay?
Have you seen Jesse since?
Huh?
Have you seen Jesse
Oh, since? Yeah. He's 20 years older than his father ever reached, or than his father was when the photo was taken, at least. More like 40 or 50 years old. I lose track of time, you know.
I think for a lot of us, if you were here in Mendocino at the time that you were going to things like the Albion People's Fair, and there was possibly you, Gary Montag, I don't know who, there were a group of people that took your photograph there. Those things are treasured in my family, those photographs. And the other wonderful thing about Albion People's Fair photographs is trying to find yourself in the picture.
Yeah, that's my saving grace, is that nearly everybody can find a picture of themselves in the crowd in my photo, in the crowd shots in my book. You know, so they, okay, I'll buy it, I'm in it. You know?
Well, if there are not any other questions, I would like to thank Chuck for making an appearance today, and thanking all of you to come and hear a little bit about. And
go ahead. I want to say one last thing about John.
Okay.
In my 86 years, and in action, Chuck's 86, I have met a lot of people, and almost I cannot think of another person who I'm talking about John Chamberlain now. I never heard a disparaging word about him from anybody. Mm-hmm. Anybody who met John, anyone knew him, had anything to do with him, had nothing but admiration to say. I wish I could say that about myself. I can't. I don't know about Chuck.
Yeah, John was a sweetheart.
A lot of people didn't like Mervin's work, but that's another story, too. I think it was great. That's it.
Oh, good.
And I have a little more to say about John, because I only got to the very beginning. So he started playing mandolin, acoustic mandolin, and he began playing with another guy named Mark Levine, and they made the Mark Levine Review. There's a picture of the upper picture there of the two of them in a doorway in an old stable, a Dutch door. And then he started playing with the offshoots of Cat Mother. After Cat Mother broke up and left town in 73 or so, then there was the Mark Levine Review. It started out as just the two of them, and it grew to have additional members. And also there was the Greenwood Sidemen, which is what John and Roy Michaels, the had been the bass player in Cat Mother, called themselves, and it grew to various sizes, and eventually that morphed into a band called Horse Pedortes. So John became quite an accomplished musician, especially as a sideman. He did some shows on his own later on, late in his life, but through all of it he was a wonderful artist and very creative, had great ideas. It was always funny, there was always humor, joking kind of involved. Like, for example, the fourth annual End of the World Dance, you know. And as he said in an interview, he said there were actually two fourth annual End of the World Dances, because when it was time for the third one, we thought it was the fourth, so I did a poster for the fourth annual, and then the next year we realized, oh, okay, well, we'll have another fourth annual. But
speaking of the Greenwood Sidemen, my favorite poster is the one John did with my dad in it at the Greenwood at the Casper Inn. Where he said, "You can't get much more local than the Greenwood Sidemen."
Yeah.
And he's lining up a pull shot. And he did a poster of him. I don't know if you have a copy of that here. Chuck, you gotta.
We had many John Chamberlain posters down in the archives.
So I'd like to repeat again, thank you for making our afternoon so interesting with all this reminiscence about the 70s and the art world, and I thoroughly enjoyed it, and I hope all of you have as well. So thank you, Bruce, thank you, Chuck, and thank you, Nick. And Katie, of course, and again, Maynard. I'd like to make a couple of announcements. The museum has a few changes going on. As was mentioned earlier, Karen McGrath has moved to Sioux Falls, and we wish her all the best. We miss her. And we're very fortunate to have Marguerite O'Brien, who has stepped in as our curator. She is here today. Marguerite. So, when you're by the office, come and introduce yourself, and I'm sure she'd like to meet you and help you if there's something you're interested in. Also,
we have books from Mervinius's cartoon book. We have his photography book.
Yes.
We have Chuck's posters for sale in the office. They're in the kitchen here. If
yes.
You're interested.
Yes. And I'm always campaigning for more docents so that the museum can stay open as much as possible. If you have any interest in joining, Jane Tillis can answer questions or I can answer questions, and it's a really wonderful experience to meet the visitors who come in. And also for membership in the museum. Please join if you haven't already. It's important that we have as much support as possible. So with that, I think it wraps things up, and thank you so much for coming.
Well, Judy, you might mention the current exhibit that we're in the middle of here.
Oh, well, yes, that is.
It's been on the whole summer, but it ends in about 2 weeks.
It does. It does. Thank you. Yep. So,
get it on your
calendar. Tell your